My name is Monika Wieland Shields, and I'm the co-founder and director of the Orca Behavior Institute. We're a nonprofit based on San Juan Island, Washington, with the mission of conducting non-invasive behavioral and acoustic research on the killer whales of the Salish Sea. Today, I'm going to give you a short tutorial about the acoustic communication of southern resident killer whales.
When I first met the southern residents, it was also around the first time permanent hydrophones were being installed at Lime Kiln Point State Park on the west side of San Juan Island. I was immediately taken by their unique squeaks and squeals and wondered how and what such a complex social society was communicating about. Now there are a series of streaming hydrophones online and anyone can listen in to the whales and all the other underwater sounds of the Salish Sea at orcasound.net or through SMRU's Lime Kiln Hydrophone. The way toothed whales or odontocetes produce sound is very different from terrestrial mammals. Most mammals make sound by passing air through their larynx, which includes what we commonly call vocal cords in humans. Odontocetes, including orcas, make most sound through their nasal passages, controlled by phonic lips on air sacs located below their blowhole. Imagine the squeaky sounds you can create by holding and manipulating the mouth of an inflated balloon, though with a much finer level of control. Odontocetes project outgoing sounds through fatty tissue in their foreheads called melons, which has a density similar to that of seawater. While they do have ear canals, they actually receive most sound through their lower jaws, which conducts incoming acoustic information directly to their inner ears. Orcas can produce three types of vocalizations: clicks, whistles, and discrete calls. Clicks, or echolocation, are very short, broadband sounds that the whales use to navigate or forage. While orcas have good ability to see both above and below the surface of the water, they live in murky seas that severely limit their visibility. By using echolocation, they can create an acoustic map of the world around them to find their way, find each other, and find food. Their need to do this has led to the evolution of a very advanced acoustic processing region in their brain. They can process sound in ways we can only imagine. Whistles are the most common vocalizations of most dolphins, and orcas, as the largest member of the dolphin family, also whistle. They sound to us a lot like human whistles, simple in their complexity and varying in length from less than a second to tens of seconds long. But compared to other members of the dolphin family, whistling in orcas is relatively rare. Discrete calls are the primary social vocalization of killer whales. These 1 to 2 second long pulsed calls occur in both stereotyped or variable versions. The stereotyped calls, which have been given alphanumeric designations by scientists like the whales themselves, have been documented to be stable call types for more than 60 years. Discrete calls make up the most distinct components of different dialects between different groups of whales. Dialects are defined as forms of language unique to certain social groups or regions. Some species, such as humans and orcas, have both geographic and social dialects. Orca dialects are learned by calves from the matrilineal groups in which they live. In the Northeast Pacific, all three ecotypes of orcas, residents, bigs, and offshores, make different vocalizations from one another. Even within an ecotype, different populations, such as the northern residents and southern residents, have completely different sets of calls from one another. J, K, and LPod of the southern residents are all considered part of one acoustic clan, meaning that they share at least some call types with one another, but each pod still uses a distinct subset of calls, allowing them to be acoustically identified. This means that when you're listening to orcas over a hydrophone, experienced listeners can determine not only which population of whales they are listening to, but often which pod or pods are present, even without seeing the whales visually. All southern resident discrete calls were categorized by the Canadian scientist John Ford. All the designations start with an S for southern resident and a number for the order in which they were identified. There are about 30 calls in total, with each pod using some but not all of the call types. The most common calls for J-pod include what I call descending or cascading calls, such as S1, S7, and S12. JPod also makes a unique call that some say sounds like a sheep or a goat, the S4. KPod is distinct in that many of their vocalizations are higher pitched, making them sound like kittens, especially with their S16 and S17 vocalizations. LPod is more diverse in their common call types, with different subgroups using different calls. Most of LPod can be identified by the S19, an ascending whistle-like call, which I'll play first. The L12 subgroup of LPod is more easily identified by the S2 type 3 vocalization, which I'll play second. I'd like to say that SuperPods, when the entire Southern resident community is together, are greater than a sum of their parts, because you hear a lot more call types in these highly social contexts than you usually hear when a single pod is present. You may recognize some of the call types I just played in this upcoming SuperPod clip, but you'll also hear many other unique sounds. Listening to something like that begs the question of what the whales are saying, bringing me back to my initial fascination with orca communication. Despite more than 40 years of acoustic research, the answer is still very much that we have no idea what they're talking about. Call types are not linked to specific behaviors, such as a certain call for, "I found a salmon," or "I'm going to breach." They also aren't linked to specific behavioral contexts, such as a subset of calls used for foraging and another subset used for traveling. All I can figure is that with their big brains, specially attuned to processing sound, we're barely scratching the surface of our understanding of what information discrete calls might be carrying. It's tempting as humans to try and categorize sounds into words or letters, as in human language, but it's important to remember that discrete call type categories are themselves human designations. What sounds to us like the same vocalization in actuality contains many minute differences in duration, frequency, and amplitude. So to the whales, those subtle differences might carry a lot of important information. What if a discrete call isn't a word, but an entire sentence or paragraph? It's amazing to think about what the whales could be communicating that we just can't crack into.
Even though we aren't any closer to figuring out what orcas are talking about, there are still many aspects of their acoustic communication that we can study further. Here at the Orca Behavior Institute, we're taking a look at the social context of their discrete call usage, seeing if the calls that they use change depending on which whales they're communicating to. For instance, one whale that we're really interested in is L87 Onyx, to see if his call usage has changed or not changed as he's switched from LPod to KPod to JPod. We're also taking a closer look at whistle communication in the Southern residents, inspired in part by a project from our 2020 intern. We're currently writing up a paper for publication on whistles that should be available later this year. Finally, with Big's killer whales spending more time in the Salish Sea, we have new opportunities to look at their discrete call usage in greater detail as well, so there are a lot of topics out there for further study. I hope you'll agree with us that orca acoustic communication is one of the most interesting aspects of their behavior to study, even if we haven't yet cracked the code as to how their communication really works.